Building your own CNC can be a bit intimidating at first because you've got to deal with mechanics, electronics, as well as the entire software part to make the machine run. But there are so many great tutorials out there, and the parts are very easily available and affordable, which makes building your own machine a really fun project. In this video, I want to show you how I built my own machine, which has really taught me a lot. I want to share my experience with you, and maybe I can inspire you to try it on your own. I'm Roman, let's get started. The CNC has three axes, is 86 cm long, 71 cm wide and 60 cm tall, and has a workable volume of 63 by 48 by 12.5 cm. The machine is driven by four nema 23 stepper motors, one each for the X and Z axis and two for the Y axis. Even though I wanted to keep the costs down, the goal was to build a machine where all moving parts were going to run on ball bearings. I therefore used linear rail guides with carriages that run on ball bearings and ball screws. As always on my channel, I wanted to use natural materials where possible. That's why I chose a combination of birch plywood and solid beechwood for the machine frame. The idea was that the relatively high stiffness of beechwood in a combination with the U and L shaped cross sections of the axles would provide a high enough stiffness for the frame. So first I needed to cut the plywood to size and plate the beechwood to the needed dimensions. I have a very good friend with an amazing woodwork shop, and I'm very fortunate to have the chance to go there and cut my own materials. Now with the frame materials cut, let's have a look at the complete parts list. There are the parts for the frame, two linear rails for each axis with two carriages each, the lead screws, four stepper motors, the motor couplers and the motor drivers, two drag chains, a couple of switches and limit switches, an Arduino Uno with CNC shield, a DC power supply, a router, and various screws and cables. As always, the complete parts list can be found in the video's description below. The square beech timbers had to be joined with the plywood to build the frame for the three axes, and I connected them with lamellos. I made sure while planning that the dimensions allowed for a perfectly flush surface of the linear rails with the ball screws. Back in my workshop, I gave the parts a quick sanding and glued the pieces together. Next, I prepared the two midsections of the frame. They are U-shaped, which gives the frame stiffness, but was also going to provide room for housing all the electronics. In the same way I connected the axes, I also joined these parts and glued them together. Then I made all the necessary cutouts and holes for mounting the electronics and for providing airflow for cooling. After making all the holes, these two parts looked like this. You're going to see later what all the cutouts are used for exactly. Now all that was left to do to finish the main frame was to connect the two midsections with the sides. These pieces I also glued together. I had previously pre-drilled all the necessary holes for the linear rails, and with this the machine was ready to get some color accents by spray painting all the beechwood parts in my channel's green signature color. Next, I drew up the shape of the two sides of the gantry and cut them out with the jigsaw. I also drilled the holes that were needed to screw the sides to the gantry, as well as for mounting the X-axis motor. Finally, I also drilled the holes for the connecting screws into the gantry. I then screwed the linear rails in place. When pre-drilling the holes, I had already made sure that the rails were going to be in a perfectly straight line. Now, while screwing the rails on, I double-checked with a ruler that they were nicely aligned before finally tightening the screws. I was now able to work out the positioning for the holes of the carriages to mount the set to the X-axis, as well as for mounting the whole gantry to the frame. These are the final pieces, with the motor mount on the left side. Next up, I made the pieces to mount the two Y and the Z-axis stepper motors to the frame. They require the same drilling pattern that I had drilled in the gantry side and were going to be mounted like so. I first attached a coupler to the motor before screwing the stepper motors to the plywood mounts. The parts could then be mounted to the back of the frame with screws. From now on, I didn't use any glue anymore for the assembly of the machine to grant access to all parts in case I needed to dismantle the machine for maintenance or troubleshooting. In case of the Y-axis motor, I had to insert one of the connecting screws before because it would be blocked by the stepper motor. With the motors in place, it was time to mount the ball screws. They came as a set, including the ball nut, a ball nut housing which allowed for easier connection to the sides in my case, two end supports and the actual screw. Putting the parts together was very easy and straightforward. With the assembled ball screws, I could now determine their position and mark the mounting holes and pre-drill them. Using the two set screws, I connected the other side of the motor coupler to the ball screw and fixed it into place. The mainframe and the X-axis were now almost finished. So I joined the two sides with the gantry by screwing them together with some very rigid flat head hex drive furniture screws, which allow for very strong and sturdy screw connections. One topic I haven't talked about yet are the limit switches, but I had planned to install two per axis to secure against over travel and having the option to use them as homing switches. I installed them right next to the end supports of the ball screws and routed a short length of cable to the back of the gantry for an easy connection later on. With round head screws on the back of the corresponding axis, I was now going to be able to trigger them. So I worked out the exact locations and put in the screws. This turned out to be a really practical and almost invisible solution and worked out really well. At this point, I was now able to join the set to the Y axis. I could neither install the ball screw nor the linear rails before because they were going to cover up some of the mounting holes. The contact surface of the carriages was actually quite small. That's why I cut some aluminum spacers to bridge the gap in the middle and increase the surface and avoid crushing the plywood when tightening the screws. Next, I put the ball screw in place and installed the stepper motor. Then I finally screwed the last two linear rails in place and secured the ball screw and the motor coupler. The last missing piece now was the mount for the router. The Makita router that I had previously owned came with an angular bracket that I had never used before, so I repurposed it as the router mount for the CNC. I had to take it apart and make some changes to make it work for this application. For mounting the bracket to the frame, I made an adapter piece from two sections of beechwood that was also going to get the green color accent. I simply had to cut out the same radius as the aluminum bracket until I had a nice fit. Next, I drilled the mounting holes into the base plate and then screwed the bracket to it. I had slightly tapered the bracket and the base plate, simply for a more elegant look. I also put the screws to actuate the limit switches in the back of the plate. Finally, I attached the aluminum bracket, and with that, the entire part was ready to be mounted to the gantry. I put the gantry onto the main frame and very carefully erected it to its final position and secured it with a screw. Then I inserted the rest of the screws. On the now almost complete machine frame, I installed the drag chains for the X and Y axis. I cut some plywood pieces to which I attached the drag chains. I screwed one piece to the back of the vertical axis, exactly below the hole through which I had already routed the cables of the limit switches. The other end was fixed as well. The other piece was screwed to the side of the gantry, with the drag chain running on top of the left side of the frame. The chain could be simply shortened to the required length by removing some of the chain links and reattaching the end piece. The final missing frame piece was the machine bed. The plan was to have a series of threaded inserts that would allow to fix a spoilboard or a working piece in place by using holding down clamps. I therefore drilled a series of evenly spaced holes in which I screwed the threaded inserts for M6 screws. When this was done, the machine bed could be put in place and the machine frame was finished. Installing the electronics and the software were the next tasks. You can click on the link to see part 2 of the build and also to watch the first run of the machine. Thank you for watching and see you in part 2. Bye for now!